Word about the music this morning. The Prelude and Offertory are by Felix Mendelssohn. They're two of the number of short pieces that he wrote that he simply gave songs without words. That's what I'm doing for Prelude and Offertory this summer. The special music is by Maurice Ravel. It's probably his most best-known piece, particularly in the orchestral version, but it was originally a piano piece. Pavane. Now, a pavane is a slow, on Wikipedia, a courtly dance of the 16th or 17th century, performed usually in costume. It's slow and stately. Now, but the subtitle of this is Pavane for a Dead Princess. It may sound better in French. Ravel was asked, what about this? He says, oh my. He says, this is not a pavane for somebody who's passed away. What I'm picturing is this, a little princess of the ancient times doing this dance, and this is her pavane. So that's what you can think of when we have a special music.
Thank you. Can you hear us now?
Much better.
Okay. Move the mic back. Okay, so I don't think I have any announcements for today, but welcome everybody. Thank you for bearing with me. Mike Clark here is our speaker for the day. He's going to lead us in our worship. We have him on the piano. Thank you, Jim. So now Mike's going to lead us in the call to worship.
Please join me in the call to worship. The world belongs to God. How good it is. How wonderful. Love and faith come together. Now we'll have our unison prayer of invocation. O God, you have set before us a great hope that your realm will come on earth and have taught us to pray for its coming. Make us ready to thank you for the signs of its dawning and to work the perfect day when your will shall be done. In the name of Jesus, we ask for your blessings, just as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Wow. Thank you, Jim. That was beautiful. Just blows my mind to think of you playing that and doing that. Just amazing job. So I wanted to say thank you to my wife, who's not with us today. This was actually supposed to be her time. And unfortunately, she had to change schedules around. And so I get the opportunity to lead you all this morning. And I'm going to start with a scripture reading. And the scripture this morning is going to come from the book of Deuteronomy. It's chapter 8, verses 7 through 10. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with brooks, streams, and deep springs gushing out into the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing, a land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. So you may wonder why I chose this scripture for the reading this morning. And because this kind of got dropped on me last minute, I really hadn't done a whole lot of thoughts. And I was thinking about, you know, what do I want to convey this morning? And what do I want to be as a part of the meditation this morning? And And a big part of it for me was I thought, well, let me start with a little bit of my faith journey of how I got to where I'm at. And then I started thinking about, well, what was one of those things that was one of those foundational things that really set me on the path? And the beauty of faith journeys and paths like that are there are many of them. I think, you know, Robert Frost probably had a poem in there somewhere about, you know, two roads diverged and many paths. But faith journeys, especially from my perspective, are things that are unique to the individual, and they kind of wander, meander. You kind of come in, you go out. And at least for me anyway, it's been this opportunity to explore and learn along the path. But one of the things that set me as a foundation, and I'll start with my parents and my grandfather, who was a Methodist minister. So I grew up in the church, knowing that church was just a part of what we did. And the other thing that my parents gave me as a gift as a child was an opportunity to go to church camp. And that's what really kind of got me thinking about what set me on this path and on my journey. And I think, you know, now that we're in summer and kids are going off to camp and going places, I thought about what was my experience like and what was church camp like for me. And so I wanted to share with you all, and that's why I chose that reading, because the reading from Deuteronomy is kind of about the land and what the land gives back and what we learn from it and how we be thankful in that land and what God has provided for us. And that if you go back, that was actually a part of the journey of the Israelites coming out from the wilderness and that opportunity for God to provide for them on their journeys. So for me, that experience of camping and providing and living off the land kind of thing was something that I got to experience from church camp. And so I wanted to kind of share with you some lessons from church camp. This is different than all the things that I needed to know. You know, I learned in kindergarten, there's lots of books and things about that, but I've never seen anything about this. What did you learn in church camp and how do those lessons apply? So I'm going to share with you some of those things that I learned along the way. And one of the earliest things that we did, you know, was we learned to work together. And we were taught this. And, oh, I forgot to mention that I actually went to church camp in this Beach City, Ohio. And it's at Brewster, Ohio, Beach City. It's all part of Eastern, kind of the Canton area. I know if Dave McClave is listening or hears this recording, he'll probably remember it, because where he grew up in New Philadelphia is not too far from this location. So kind of these beautiful wooded rolling hills that was a part of. So it gave a lot of opportunity for canoeing, biking, hiking, and camping under the stars and all those things that you think about. And so for me, going to this camp, Camp Wanakee, which was an Indian name for beautiful hills, was the opportunity to first and foremost get out of my own backyard. It was an opportunity to get away from my town and where I was at, and get a chance to experience and meet other children and other youth and really other kids that came from different backgrounds, came from different religious experiences, and really came from a lot of a variety of thinking. So that became a unique opportunity to kind of see that, oh, well, things are different than the way where I grew up and what they did. And it was an opportunity to learn from others. But it also made us work together. And one of the early stories that they used to read to us as campers was they would always read the story of the lonely camper, the camper that thought he could do everything, that could come in and because he knew everything, could put the camp together and do everything and you know, take all the jobs. And I got this, I got this, I got this. And soon he learned that you couldn't. In order to build a lean-to and in order to build the tables and the things that we need, the campfire circles, and to get the wood and get everything you need to properly put together a campsite, it took a group and it took an effort. And that was something that I always was interested in, because it was always one of those things I kind of grew up as a kid. It was trying to always be, how do I do this on my own? And how do I, you know, I don't need anybody. I got this, you know. I think I probably instilled that in my daughter. I remember my kids as they were growing up, I was like, you know, I do it myself. And that was sort of a little bit of me as a kid too. And so going to camp and learning to work with others and learning to figure out how you share that workload. You couldn't just be the one doing nothing, but you couldn't be the one doing everything. So that was a valuable lesson that I think, even to this day, that still apply when we go back. And I always think that, and I've actually even used that story in a work environment of the lonely camper, and don't be the lonely camper, because even if you were to succeed and get it through, it's a very lonely experience when you're the only one there and you've done all the work and now there's no one to share it with and there's no one to share the opportunities and the beauty with. So another thing that it also taught was learning how to serve. One of the things that they instilled in us at the camp was every one of us got to be what they called hoppers. And the hopper was the person that was actually going to serve the rest of the campers. We would go and eat our meals when we were in, we called it the barn. But when you were in the barn eating inside, we had a table that was with our 10 campers and our two counselors. And we would take turns, and you took turns of being the hopper, going up and grabbing the family style food and bringing it back to the table for everyone else to eat. And then you also were the one that then picked up all the dishes at the end and took them up, so that we didn't have chaos of 100 kids, all trying to run around and get their food and everything. You had two per table that were designated as the hoppers, but that was an important lesson that you had to serve others as well. And so that was something that, again, stayed with me. And I laughed too that even in my time in the military, there were many opportunities where I got a chance to serve in a chow hall and actually serve the food for others. And it just brought back a lot of those memories from my time at camp. The other thing that really was important for me was learning to tell a good story. I learned so many different stories, like the Lonely Camper. There was another one that was always shared with us. It was called the Warm Fuzzies. I don't know if any of you have ever heard that one, the Warm Fuzzies, Cold Pricklies, but the Warm Fuzzies and Cold Pricklies, it was all about how do you treat people with kindness and how do you make sure that people that you give warm fuzzies to, those are smiles, those are thank yous, those are hellos. That is what brings people healing. Cold Pricklies and being, on your own and being selfish does nothing to help the environment. And so that was a really, those stories that we heard along the way were very similar to a lot of the parables that Jesus would tell. And so we would interweave these stories that we would learn as kids with parables that we would hear about in the Bible. And so it was important for me to understand the concepts of good storytelling and understand how those stories can really be impactful, because when you tell them to children and you can put in a little bit more of that, how it applies and how you can see things in worlds other than just in ancient times. The Bible to a kid seems like it's, that's something that was a long time ago, but you make that relevant to today's world and take those same sort of stories. So that storytelling is something that has always stuck with me. I love to tell a good story. I love to share experiences and try and make those things that are applicable in today's world. The other thing that it was interesting to me was also scripture and how actually scripture could be interpreted. Each time that I went to camp, we always had just one book of the gospels that was kind of the focus for that week. And so we would take time to read that scripture, and then we would actually then debate it amongst one another. What did that really mean? And it was our first kind of, you think about Bible school, and you think about, book clubs and other things like that, where you debate what is the real meaning and the intent of these things. This allowed us the opportunity as kids to actually talk about what we were seeing, what we were reading out of there, and what that really meant to us, and how to actually see what that was and how we would take that and bring that to today's environment. So that was an early opportunity for us to really understand, that the scripture can be different to different people. Just the way I read something doesn't mean that everybody else is going to see it the same way. It also taught me that praying is a team sport and an individual sport. We were really given a lot of opportunities to kind of go off. And this was the nice thing about being in a secluded kind of campground environment, that when we would go off in our group, we would not only do these scripture readings, but then we would have these times alone. And it was opportunities for us to do what we wanted. It was really, we were taught early on that communing with God can be done in many different ways. And it doesn't always have to be through rote prayer. It doesn't have to even be through verbalized prayer. Sometimes it could just be what's in your head, the thoughts that you have and the thoughts that you're sharing with God individually. But then we would always come back and include that into the group prayer to talk about where people were at with prayers, concerns, similar to the way we do things here in church today, where we share those concerns across the community, but you also have that opportunity for private prayer, private communication with God. And that was an important lesson for me to learn early on, that prayer doesn't always have to be done in church. Prayer can be done in many places, and prayer can be done in many locations. And prayer can be done not just when you're in need, but prayer can be done at, a lot of times. It was that opportunity to do it in times when you were just alone with your thoughts, kind of secluded, and then what was inspiring and what were the things that you were thankful for in the environment around you. The other thing that we did a lot as campers is we did a lot of singing. I don't do it all that well. This is why I've never joined the choir at church, but love to do it. But I'm just not very good at it, as my kids can attest, and as they've had to put up with me in car rides and singing my songs along the way. And there's a lot of those camp songs that I still, you know, resonate with me today. And there's still things that I will occasionally belt out to my children, even though much to their chagrin. But singing and that opportunity to sing and how it makes things easier. So it made the hikes that we were doing seem shorter. It made the chores that we were doing as we were doing things seem like they were less about chores and more about fun. And I think about that too, you know, and I laugh too, because there's a lot of those things that, that again, I've tried to instill in my children as, hey, we're going to sing our way through our chores. And, you know, again, they hate it when I do the singing, but they love it when they're the ones doing it and they get to pick the song. So singing was something that was just, it was an important part of what we learned to do, good, bad, or the other. The other thing that as a part of that, then we also learned that a sanctuary can be wherever you make it. I used to love the fact that we would do these vespers, morning and evening vespers, on a hill. And many times it wasn't necessarily, if we couldn't make it back to the vesper location, we would do it wherever we were at as a group. And we would have those vespers in the evening, sometimes on a hillside, sometimes in front of a fire, sometimes it was in front of a lake. It could even be if we were on a hike, we would just stop and do it wherever we were at. And that was important for me to learn, that sanctuary isn't just about being in a church. Sanctuary is wherever you are. And sanctuary is wherever you are with others to be able to share that experience. And that was important for us. And speaking of campfires, campfires were also an important part of you know, the experience. And for me, it was one of those things, I'm mesmerized by fire, and especially campfires. I'm not a pyromaniac, and don't worry, I'm not going to burn things down. But it is one of those things that when you're at a campfire and you're watching it burn and you watch those embers come down, it really gives you that chance for reflection. And it gives you that chance to really think. And it kind of casts different shadows on things. So it gives a different lens and a different light and a different view to a lot of different activities and thoughts. And it just, to me, that's always something that has stuck with me. Not only how to start a fire, because that was a part of what we learned in the camp, of how to start fires if you don't have matches. How do you then, you know, what are other things that you can use to get that started? But then also, then that understanding of fire safety as well, to make sure that you're not burning down the forest while you're out there. But it was also just that opportunity to do that reflection and those thoughts around campfires. And we did s'mores every now and then too, so that was always a nice little benefit. The other thing that was, it was learning to make the most out of anything in terms of weather conditions. You know, the one thing that we were learned, we were there for a week. And so that one week that we were there, didn't matter what the weather was, we were going to go and do our thing. So that was a very important lesson to learn early on, that you persevere, you push through. If it's a rainy day, you turn it into a rain hike. If it's a sunny, hot day, then you turn it into a lake day. And so you kind of change and adapt to what's going on in there. And so you don't let that dictate your mood. You don't let that dictate the, oh, it's going to be a horrible day because it's raining out today like it is here. But you just learned to push through it. And I loved some of those rain hikes, the things that you would see as the water's dropping off the leaves. And what would that do to animals? What would that do to the smells of the forest and the area where we were at? How did that change that? And that was a really important lesson for me to have, especially when I moved to Seattle, Washington, where it seemed like it rained every day. Knowing that hey, you just put on a good pair of boots and a nice raincoat and off you go. You persevere through all of that. So learning that lesson and learning how to do that and learning how to even make meals in that weather. So what do you do? You know, if you still are going to try and cook, a campfire, how do you do that in weather, and how do you then make sure that, all right, we're going to adjust instead of doing things over the open fire, maybe we're going to build it to the coals and put things on a shelter so that we can actually build these hot stoves and things like that. It was also about improvising, adapting, and overcoming, which was, again, part of, I think, you know, that's what led me to that scripture in Deuteronomy, was like being able to make things out of the land. We learned a lot to recycle and use other tools and other things that we found either in the environment or things that we were able to reuse. I'll never forget being able to use a tuna can and taking pieces of cardboard, wrapping it up in the tuna can, pouring wax over the top of it. And boom, all of a sudden you had a burner. And you had something that once that was lit with a few wicks in it that you had placed in there, that thing would last and that thing would turn into a nice little burner for cooking things. So being able to do that, improvise, adapt, and overcome, that was a lesson that I learned as a youth that then I took forward to and applied many, many times through my career in the military, being able to make the best with what you got. And also being able to then, you know, I call it kind of the MacGyvering of being able to say, well, all right, we learned to lash things together. And so, you know, we took that opportunity to say, hey, we're going to fix this thing by just all we had with us was twine. So what can we lash together to make things stay together? And that was a lesson that I laugh and my kids will attest to this one. I feel the world can be fixed with basically two things, duct tape and WD-40. Because if it sticks and it's not supposed to, spray it with some WD-40, it loosens right up. But if it doesn't stick and it's supposed to, you just duct tape it. So yeah, you know, and it's very true. I've even done that with golf shoes. I've done it with a golf bag. I've done it with many of my kids' toys, duct tape anything and everywhere. So yeah, they know the lessons of duct tape and WD-40. The other thing that I laugh at too, and so this was one that, swimming equals showering. So when you're young and you're a kid, right? You know, you go to the pool because we would go to this pool or a lake. And when you were swimming, hey, that counts as a shower, doesn't it? I don't know. That's a lesson that I really wanted to carry forward. I actually believe in showering now as an adult, but as a kid, that was a wonderful thing to be able to just jump in the water, kind of splash yourself off and say, there's my shower for the day. I'm good. One of the other things that the lessons that I did retain, or well, didn't do very well though, was we also wrote letters home. So as a part of being a camper and being away from home for a week, one of the things that we would do each day was we had this quiet time. We called it horizontal time, H time, where we were supposed to be lying in our beds. I mean, I guess you could kind of call it nap time, but we were at an age where it was like, we're beyond naps. Cause I started these in second grade and went all the way through high school. And so by the time you get into your junior high age, it's one of those things where you don't really need a nap, but the lesson stayed with us that that's time that you're going to be in your bunk. And so you're either reading or you're writing. And a lot of us, this was our first experience of writing home because it was our first time away from home for an extended period of time, not just an overnight. And so we learned to write letters home, and we learned to write letters to friends, either previous campers that we had been with or other people that we were pen palling with. I have to say, though, I did not do very well with that lesson. It was a great thing. I did it at camp, and I didn't apply very well. My wife can attest to that, too. I'm not much of a letter writer today. But it's one of those things that, again, was ingrained in me, though, of that being able to write a letter and understanding what that is. So the other thing that, you know, the last thing that, I, you know, kind of bring up as a part of this was how to actually take all these lessons and then bring them back. Right. So we would spend this wonderful week at camp, and you get to make these great friends. And I never forgot those feelings on that Saturday. We would start on a Monday and go through Saturday. And that feeling on Saturday morning when you're saying goodbye to these kids that were total strangers when you first all got together on Monday, and to these camp counselors that were total strangers to you. But then that feeling and that bonding that you had over that week of having to say goodbye and actually doing that separation. Every time you spend a week at camp and then saying goodbye to those folks, trying to stay in touch with them through letters, but also understanding that there's probably a lot of those folks you'll never see again. I went back last night, and I was actually going back to the old website from Camp Wanakee, and I was looking at some of they had some staff photos that were from the years when I was there. And this camp actually started in 1947. I'm not quite that old yet that I didn't start there when the camp started, but it goes back a ways, and they had pictures that dated back from my era of being a camper at this place. And it just, even then, seeing those faces and seeing those folks and seeing those, they brought back so many thoughts and memories, and pleasant thoughts and memories of things that we did, things that we learned, and things that then I think very fondly on over time. And so there's a lot of times that, you know, I say, well, all right, you know, when I have struggles or when I'm having things about self-doubt of, do I really know what I'm doing? Do I have a way ahead on this project? Do I know how I'm going to raise my kids? Do I know what I'm going to be able to do over here for this, for that, and the other? I think back to a lot of those camp experiences, and I think back to those friendships that I made, and I think back to those lessons that I learned that put me on the path and on the journey to my faith. And I'm able to call those back, and I can kind of give a nice little smile, think of a song. I don't all sing them out loud, mind you, but think of a song, think of a friend, think of a something else from there. And it really brings me back and helps ground me in what I'm doing at that moment. So those memories, and this is why I kind of went back to summer camp. I was stuck in this moment of, what am I going to say to people this morning? What am I going to talk about? It was easy. Go back to camp. Go back to those things that remember. Go back to those things that put me on my path and put me on my faith journey. And again, not everybody's experience is going to be the same. But for me, these were the things that really helped instill in me where I am and help give me a lot of those lessons for growth and exploration and other things like that that I've taken with me for the rest of my life. So my hope for you is that this helps you think about what were those things, what were those, you know, those things that set you down your path, and what were those things that you still look back on today and think, wow, these are the things that helped me become who I am on my faith journey. You know, I hope it sparks some thoughts, some synapses firing in the brain for all of you. And I hope that as a part of it, then that those memories and those things will be things that you can think back on, and things that you can think back on in times of need of, how do I then think back to those things and help me get to where I need to be going. So I thank you for listening to me today, and I thank you for the opportunity. And again, I thank my wife for sticking me with this the last minute. Thanks. It's awesome. So she's doing a great thing, though. She's not with us today because she's actually down with Julia, taking her on college visits. They were up in New York, and now they're down in Philadelphia area. And then they're going to be coming back and going up to Maine. So just wanted to say thank you for that and this opportunity. And so now we're going to move to the prayer section. And so I'm going to actually pull up the chat to see if there were any other chats, if you've got something for the Zoom folks or in the room. But I have two of them that I did want to pass on as prayer requests that Rebe had passed along. So we send prayers of healing and strength for Rebe's cousin Gail, and for Ron and Ronnie as the caregivers for her as she goes through, she's currently hospitalized going through chemo. And so we have prayers of healing and strength for Gail. I'm also wanting to send along prayers for David and Ann Nuss as Ann deals with the effects of some recent mini strokes. So I wanted to pause and see if there were any other prayer concerns from the room. I don't see any in the chat. Any other in Pilgrim Hall? Okay. All right. Well, then we will move on to the call to prayer as printed in the bulletin. God be with you. Let us pray. O God, the refuge of the poor, and the hope of the humble, the salvation of the needy, hear us as we pray for those who are worn by illness, for all who are wronged or oppressed, and for the weary and heavy laden, that they may be strengthened by your grace and healed by your consolations. Let the day spring from on high visit those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide their feet into the way of peace. Through Jesus Christ. Amen.
And now it is falling. So now it is time for our offertory. Jim can leave us in some music. I believe that it's playing around here somewhere. You might have to find it. But if not, you can send it in check to the church, or you can give online via the website. You can use PayPal or a credit card.
Thank you, Jim. And now would you please join me in the unison benediction? Go forth, for the love of God is ours to share. The peace of Christ is ours to extend. And the power of the Holy Spirit is ours to offer. Amen. I am still here.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you. It's good to see you all.
Good to see you.
What memories.